Hi, everyone. Thank you for coming. So I'm Katrina McElroy. I am in the art department, faculty in the art department, and I'm in charge of the college art gallery this semester. And our current show that just went up last night is the topic of our panel discussion. So Saul Bromberger and Sandra Hoover are our two photographers. And we are meeting with three members of the Spectrum Club here on campus. And, you know, I should have practiced names first, and yes, I didn't. So Ashley Lowe.
Hello.
And Nick Shepard.
Hello.
And Camille Mistaz.
Yes.
Hi.
So we're going to have a little conversation here with them about the work and how it relates to our community here on campus and the world at large. And we would love for all of you to chime in if you have a question or a comment you'd like to make. But I do ask that you kind of raise your hand because we want to talk into the microphone. So I will run the microphone to you. The microphone doesn't amplify, but it's recording. So it's just so that we have the audio in our recording. So just wait for me to hand the mic to you. And with that, as you can tell, I can't talk very well right now. So I'm going to, which is better because they can do more of the talking. So I will let Saul and Sandy maybe just start with a real brief introduction of themselves and the first series of work that we're going to see in the slides from the Pride Parade in San Francisco. And then we will go from there and I will find the lights.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming. This has been a project long in the making. Just a little bit about us, tell you about who we are, how we got here. I met Sandy in 1984 when I worked at a newspaper up in Hayward. I had gone to the Gay Parade on my day off, and within 20 minutes, I could tell that this was something that was just really important and essential and vital that I photograph and document. One is a test to myself to see if I had the skills to do something like this. And then two, I was seeing this community fighting for equality, for justice. Just keep going, please. I met Sandy a couple months later. We became close, and I invited her. We said let's go to the next gay parade. Sure. Let's go to the next parade, and became part of this project where we wanted to show how this community was coming together to fight for civil rights, for equality, which everyone should have. And also, as you see the slide presentation, and as you see the show, the pictures we're doing now, it's a really good document of where we're at now with the kids. So,
I think one of the things, we're talking 30 years ago, or something like that, a very different time period. LGBT, the term, didn't exist. There were no gay straight alliance groups. They didn't exist. The Pride Parade, at least the San Francisco one that is current, is, I don't even recognize it. So you got to, if you can, and you can't, we're talking a whole different world. And then with the, you'll see the pictures of the young kid, they're kids to me, going to prom, and they're so open, and they're so happy, and they're so in your face. It is just the polar opposite as to when we started 30 years ago.
All right.
Please feel free to ask questions.
Yes.
So we don't just lecture at you.
Yeah, no, I think one of the most interesting things in the images is that...
Just set it down. It's okay, Ashley.
Is that you can really see the fight in the images in the black and white and just the belief behind it all. Whereas now I feel like it's a lot different, where it's not necessarily a fight anymore. It's more of just a coexistence.
At least in the East and West Coasts and the big cities, it's hit more the mainstream. But from what I understand, if you live in a small town, in the rural areas, small states, middle of the country, I think people in the LGBT community still have to be careful. They can't be themselves, maybe, be who they are. Let me take you back to this time in the 80s. As we started shooting it and getting more involved, we just saw that there was just so many facets to cover here. And I'm looking at these photos. You've got seniors. You've got the dykes on bikes. You've got different factions in the dykes on bikes. You've got dykes and bikes that didn't like men very much. You've got dykes and bikes who tolerated them. You've got dykes and bikes who had kids. There was a wide spectrum. I mean, you had not a lot of people have asked us why not a lot of African Americans, and we don't remember much diversity.
I think there was diversity. I think on this day you saw a lot of white males because they had a better footing in society. They could kind of come out that one day, but I've heard stories after stories of meeting people who said they prayed no one recognized them. They didn't want their pictures taken by the newspapers. Fear of losing your job, you know, being outed. Just a different time. And you got to realize this is the time of AIDS. That's the biggest difference. This is the height of the AIDS epidemic. And so that everything, at the time the media talked about anything gay was AIDS. That's all of us talked about. You'd say gay, AIDS. There was no other, it was like, wow, there's other stuff going on. But it was, we couldn't get this stuff published because there was no interest in it at the time. I knew it was a historical document, and it took a little bit longer than it should have for us to bring it back out. But it's because it was AIDS equals gay. That's all we heard, gay equals AIDS. And why aren't you doing AIDS? And I mean, it's like, well, there's other things going on. And the diversity, that's the big thing I notice now when I go to the Pride Parade is much more diverse, much, much more people openly diverse.
I think that's very interesting that the first thing that we're kind of talking about is the intersectionality between that diversity and...
I think it was space bar, just buses.
So the diversity at Gay Pride. And, you know, back then, it probably was significantly less diverse. I think there was more of a stigma, especially in, you know, African American or Black communities, about being gay. And I think there's still a significant stigma versus white communities if we're looking at that kind of difference in the diversity of Gay Pride, you know?
I absolutely agree with Nick. I can say that as someone who comes from an Asian American background, there is significantly more stigma with non-white people or people of color or in those communities with being any other sexuality aside from heterosexual. And I was going to also mention with what you said about how the smaller states and smaller towns not being anywhere nearly as accepting as those in larger cities such as San Francisco or West Hollywood down here. And it just made me think about the privilege in Southern California. Is there anything you can talk about? Here in Southern California, we have just recently, at least on this campus, have made 4 all-gender bathrooms, which is a great step towards equal rights for everyone, especially for trans asterisk students here on campus. Is there anything else you can say about how privilege here is so much
like the difference between the privilege? I also kind of noted that, you know, when looking at smaller towns, how different it is and how much I think that we forget, especially our age group, living in Southern California and not necessarily feeling that stigma as much as the smaller towns would.
Absolutely.
I was reading on Facebook, a friend of ours who lives in Seattle, there was a hate crime on Capitol Hill just this past week. Seattle, Capitol Hill. So, you know, this is still going on, maybe not as much as it used to be, but I wanted to pause on this photo, because when we see the portraits of the Gay Prom, keep this photo in mind. To us, Sandy shot this. We don't know. We're assuming. The boy is kind of symbolic. but we see him kind of isolated on his own, not feeling comfortable being who he is. When you see the portraits we did last year, in 2014 and last year, I mean, it's such an affirmation, such a cry, a celebration, a cry out for joy that these teens had, so which he could not do. So, and that was shot in 1987, not that long ago, if you think about it.
I agree with that. I remember the reason I noticed this guy was probably 18 or something, is that he had this white suit on. So he, even though he was very, so he was uncomfortable, he was had enough confidence to wear a white suit, which means a lot. So in one way, he was just trying to figure out, but he was strong enough to come to that parade in a white suit, and that's what why I noticed him. And he was lost, but you know, it was different back then. I was going to go back to your. I think I've noticed with the current political, whatever you want to call it. I'm trying to stay out of it.
Turmoil, perhaps.
Perhaps turmoil. I do think there is a backlash against the LGBTQ community right now because of the marriage equality and this interesting times.
Absolutely,
and it's not being addressed really strongly in the gay community too. It's like there is a definite backlash, and especially with transgendered youth. I mean, I have never seen such asinine laws being trying to pass. And, I mean, they're just stupid.
Well,
I mean, and they're scary. They're frightening. And so I think we live near Oakland. One of the biggest transgender community lives in Oakland. But it's Oakland. There's a certain, you can kind of talk yourself into, if you live in the Bay Area in San Francisco, that it's safe here. It isn't, though, totally. And I'm sure here in Southern California and West Hollywood, you can kind of talk yourself into this is a safe place to live. But there's still beatings in San Francisco. There's murders of transgender. So I think there's a long, I mean, let's not think this fight is over, because it isn't. And there's people out there that still, I mean, they want you dead. You know, they want everyone that doesn't fit into the nice little, the box, and it scares me, because I've seen this. I've seen it for watching. I went to the first parade when I was 22, and I'm 52 now. So, I mean, I've seen a lot of things through my life, and I do definitely see this backlash happening.
In the history of America, it's going to be a constant trouble.
Oh, yeah.
Keep going.
Sorry, you were talking about small towns being in the Midwest. I spent half my life in Lincoln, Nebraska, which is dead center of the Midwest. While, yes, I had LGBTQ friends out there, it is not nearly as comfortable as it is here. Mm-hmm. They are still, like, our generation is a lot more accepting, but, you know, when you talk to adults out there, I had one of my friends who's LGBTQ visit me from here out there, and he wore a tutu around downtown because that's just what he likes to do, you know. And I had regulars that I bartended for come up to me at my work and be like, "Did he mean to wear that? Like, what is he doing?" Like, people kept staring at us and looking at us like we were crazy, and I kept getting comments about it. So, I mean, it still has that struggle. I mean, we were getting letters from our congressmen trying to pass laws that marriage equality isn't okay. And they would post it on, like, social media sites talking about how horrible this is and how it's degrading to our morals, when in reality it's just equal rights for everyone.
Yeah.
So it's
mm-hmm.
still, that stigma is still really present in the Midwest.
I agree with you. Talking about, like, the laws that they're trying to pass now and how people are still viewing this as wrong and in such a difficult light, it kind of makes my heart beat a little faster, you know? I'm transgender, and I transitioned at 16 in, like, 2006. And even then, you know, I didn't have any other people in my life who were transgender. And I didn't have things like this necessarily. As recent as, you know, less than 10 years ago. And so the contrast between looking at, you know, decades ago, where these people had to be so brave to be here at this Gay Pride Parade, knowing that there were people out there that were out to harm them and were out to, you know, destroy the sense of community that they had and the sense of safety that they had.
People had a lot of courage back when, people had so much courage back then to march up Market Street or from the Castro District. But what was happening, if you can just put yourself back 30 years ago, is community organizations were coming together. Caregivers for people with AIDS were there. You had the lesbian community that was coming together, and they oftentimes became many of the caregivers for people with AIDS. And the community, you can just see the community was coming together. And so that too was one of our goals to show.
I think the AIDS epidemic actually defined the gay community. Before that, the lesbian and gay men, they didn't mix. It wasn't until, it was like, you know, it, well, you know, it's not going to happen.
So, yeah. So what's the point?
So once the lesbian community were the people that were taking, the women were taking care of the men, and that's what made a community. I watched it unfold before our eyes. We did an AIDS documentary later on. I saw the same thing happen. It made the community. I'm not a fan of labels. I know a lot of people are, but my goal one day after I do all this stuff is I want all those labels gone. I just don't like them. I just, hi, my name's Sandy. I don't need to define who I, you know.
Yeah, I was just curious how your conversations are different or similar from back then to your conversations now within that community.
Conversations. Give me more.
Well, so for instance, I was living in New York at this time when you were up in the Bay Area and watching the evolution from New York City. Mm-hmm. And it seemed to me that, as you said, the AIDS is what defined this community. Yeah. At the time. It was community looking for respect enough to help cure a horrible disease. Mm-hmm. And that was the primary glue that brought people together. But the underlying reality is that these are human beings. And so now here we are 30 years later, and the desires of that community for respect and for the same rights that the rest of everybody else takes for granted are a priority, as opposed to fighting a disease. So I'm just wondering, you know, what your conversations look like then and look like now.
I think San Francisco community is really struggling right now, because as much as everyone wanted to be part of the mainstream, you are, and now they're not feeling so special. Their community is and the economic crisis going on in San Francisco is like almost killing the Castro District. So you have a group of people that their whole goal was to assimilate, and so they have, and now it's like, how do you define yourself past that? And hopefully you don't have to define yourself by your sexuality. It shouldn't happen. It's like you should just, go out, do whatever you want. That's what I see going on right now, and I think, I don't know outside of this area, and really, to tell you the truth, the rural communities I do think are harder, a different world. I live in Alameda, California. I nicknamed it Lesbian Central because there's so many. And they're just people, lesbian couples mostly, raising their kids and going to the grocery store. And I don't know if there's a community to say. I don't know. What do you think?
I think the conversation is that people are just more in the mainstream. At least I don't think about it much anymore. But we're now doing a project on HIV long-term survivors. The story hasn't ended. It just continues. The story now is that many of these people... Many of the people who we photographed in the 80s who had AIDS survived.
Some of them survived. Yeah.
Some of them survived. Some of them tell us we made it. Somehow we made it. And now we're photographing them when they're in their 50s and 60s. And so the conversation continues in that way. But I think they're more in the mainstream.
So the conversation hasn't necessarily changed. It's just continuing.
It's constantly continuing, yeah. Constantly.
I don't think there's an arrival point.
No, I don't think there's ever an arrival point.
I think
point.
It's a circle, and I think it's finding balance.
It's yeah.
And that's everything in life, though. No.
I can say when I grew up in Hayward, which is a suburb of the East Bay of San Francisco. My parents are very middle class. My father's a retired teacher. My mother worked for a school district. I had no idea that Hayward had this gay community. It wasn't until I went to these Pride Parade I started hearing about it. They had like this really, really big gay community with 7 bars. Once AIDS hit, they wiped out those 7 bars because there was no more bartenders. But I remember the newspaper coverage of the gay parade being, you know, they would cover the parade for one day. It was usually white male straight photographers taking pictures of the most flamboyant, least dressed, and that's what would show up in the paper. That was your only context of the gay community other than AIDS. So if you didn't seek it out, if you didn't weren't
you
a person
know.
That was, you know, wanted to know more, that's where it stopped.
Yeah.
And I think still some of that goes on.
You had mentioned earlier about how it was a long time before you had gotten, like, there were historical pictures,
yes.
Right? And it was a long time before you had actually gotten recognition for them. Mm-hmm. How long did it take? I mean,
It's
happening now.
It's happening now. 30 years.
30 years.
We have a question up here.
Before I, just 1 minute, I wanted to jump off on what Sandy, and then I'll take the question. I wanted to just follow up on what Sandy was saying, that after a Pride Parade on a Sunday, we'd open up the newspaper, and the next day, the coverage from the papers would be often shot by male photographers with a very long telephoto lens of the most flamboyant characters, people in the parade. Okay, that affected and impacted our approach to how we photographed the parade. Our intention I was not going to do that. We were going to go in and we were going to shoot with a wide angle lens. We were going to get right in the middle of things and see people up close and talk to them and not create what I felt was an exploitive, voyeuristic look at this parade, at this group of people.
It's less scandalized. It's like, I feel like even nowadays with papers, it's everything is a scandal. Everything is fantastical, you know.
That's the only thing.
Sure.
That's the only way media gets attention, right? So they have to bring out the most outrageous things for you to see, and it affects everyone else's view on them.
But it's also, I think, a preconceived notion of what the gay community perhaps was perceived by photographers who were not in the community. I'm just guessing.
Absolutely.
I don't know. Because I kept seeing it again and again. And so this was a personal project, said, we're not going to do that. In fact, there's a few photos taken in the exhibit done with a telephoto lens, and I kind of was, I remember thinking, God, you know, am I cheating? Is this
you're cheating yourself.
Am I cheating ourselves? Is this still authentic to our approach that we want to do here? Go ahead.
Hi. So you guys have been doing this continually since the 80s to now, this parade?
No.
So just when?
It ended in 1990.
So after that, I don't know if you guys worked anything with like the media, but I just wanted to say the portrayal of HIV kind of changed towards the 90s with you had Freddie Mercury was a big name with the HIV, and then Eazy-E, who was a presumably straight male, and also Magic Johnson, who contracted HIV. So how did you guys see the change in the media's portrayal of HIV during that time as a spectator, or if, I don't know if you guys continued to do photography at the time?
In the early 90s, we did a very, very, very intense documentary on AIDS. It was before the good drugs came out. There are good drugs, believe me. And I'm glad Facebook wasn't around when I was young. So when we worked from
92 to 95
in Seattle, which is a second tier city to AIDS, so they had a, they weren't as media savvy then. This is before all the internet, all that. So we had access to a, what they would probably hate me calling it, but it was a hospice at the time, because it was a time when everyone came in and they didn't come out. And so, again, we there was so much stigma about AIDS. And to this day, the HIV positive people I'm working with, it's the stigma. I mean, if you would think 30 years, you know, and the, you know, you can control it now. But it's the stigma, and that back then, it was, I think everyone thought you died. And you, and honestly, a lot of that was going on. But when the drugs came in, everyone started living a little bit more, and then the story was over. You didn't hear about it as much. But HIV is a virus, it's still around. Any one of you can get it. It's not taking a pill to get it. You can control it, but I definitely would not want to contract it. The media, I think it's gone to the back page. That's one of the reasons we're doing this HIV project, because I think everyone thinks it's over. It's not over. Living with HIV is very difficult. The medicines, this is a, these guys are in their 50s, not these guys, I mean, there's women too. it's like they're in their 50s now. They have been taking these drugs for 30 years. No one knows what effects it has on their health. And so that's why the story we're working on now. Let's not let the people that I knew die of this disease. I want these people to have respect.
I don't want to interrupt you, but when you finish up that thought, just because we have the prom images coming behind you, maybe you can address those too, and so everyone knows kind of what they're looking at. And
can we start from the top then?
Yeah. Sure.
Okay, the gay prom.
We 2 years ago, we wanted to take this project out of the boxes in our basement. And start showing them. So we were able to get an agreement to show them in a gallery, a small community gallery in Hayward. And in due time, we were invited to do portraits of teens at the 20th annual gay prom at Chabot College in Hayward. And so that's how we got involved with this. And within 10, 15 minutes, I remember getting chills, just like, oh my, you know, this is just wonderful. Just a real celebration, and how a real indication of how much things have changed. You know, that kids now 13, 14, 15 can really feel like they can be who they are and not hide it. The prom starts, it's really amazing, really nice. You've got a red carpet, and you've got a line of people, and the teens walk down the red carpet, and everyone claps for them and sings for them. It's really nice. So that's how that started. And then we started doing these portraits, and some of the kids, some of the teens, just came to life before our camera. It was just magic.
It's actually interesting that that's what it's about. We're currently trying to work with CSUN right now, mm-hmm. and they're holding a gay prom. It's something we're still in works with, but they're still trying to like hash out all the details. But it's going to be interesting actually being able to experience that. Mm-hmm.
Can I just say how remarkable it is to me, how many, when I look at these photos, the diversity of gender expression that comes out in you know, these teens. Like I said, when I was 16 and I was transitioning, like, I didn't see anything like this. Mm-hmm. And it's very remarkable to me when I was looking at it in the gallery. I kind of started to cry because I got very emotional looking at them and how happy these kids are and how comfortable they seem to be expressing themselves in whatever way that they felt that was who they were and who they wanted to express themselves as. Mm-hmm. And I just thought that was really remarkable. I just wanted to note that.
means it's working.
Yes, absolutely.
I also want to say that the change and diversification in these two sets of photos is also quite remarkable, seeing how you have many more people of color in this set of photos compared to the pictures of the Pride Parade. Mm-hmm. It just shows how far the community has come in fighting for their rights, and it makes me pretty happy to see that these kids are very confident in who they are now compared to the lone young man in the photos before. Mm-hmm. And they look so happy and not lost. They found who they are. And I think you've captured that really well in this set photos.
Thank you. Oh. I forgot about this. When we started showing this again, of course, high schools heard about it. I can't remember the sequence. So we occasionally will speak at high schools, and we put on a whole show for them with using the prom and the older stuff. And after one of these, and we bring people, much like we bring people along that were know me from way back, and some people I don't know. And after one of these very long days of showing this show period after period, this very quiet girl waited till everyone left the room and came up to me and handed me this note. She came out to me. And I'm like, wow. It's like, all I could think of is, isn't there anyone else in your life other than this beat up old photographer that you want to give this letter to? And I was very touched by it. That by looking at these pictures, she realized some of the things she was going through, that she was coming out and she was figuring it out. And the same time, the next slide. So this girl came up and put this on my wrist. And again, it was, that's all we were trying to, with these pictures, show respect for everyone. No one had, you know, equality for everyone, period. It's not one group over the other getting a little bit more. It's just, and I find that the youth are way, way more open. And now I have a cutoff. I can almost tell your age, because 50 and above, you don't talk about it still a lot. You know, it's kind of like, okay, you know, but we're not really going to go there, because there's a lot of people kind of like in the closet still, even though everyone knows you're gay or lesbian or whatever. You have, and it's 50 and above, and 50 and below, they're okay. But yeah, it's a 15 above. You have to watch. They're, you know, working through things still. They are. And I'm so happy to see so many. The biggest thing I'm noticing is the transgender community. Huge, huge. I mean, these kids that are 14, even younger. And you could answer it better than me. To have a group of people that you're not by yourself. You're not going through it by yourself.
It's so remarkable. Because even though I went, you know, to a very progressive high school, I went to a theater arts high school, Santa Sue. I did go to Santa Sue. There were a lot of, you know, gay and lesbian teens on campus. But at the time that I began transitioning, it was just me. And so finding that community and seeking it out was something that was difficult at the time. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, group therapy and things like that were where you found, mm-hmm. you know, other transgender people, and they were usually older than you. Mm-hmm. But even after I graduated, the school would reach out to me, counselors would reach out to me and be like, hey, I have this student who, you know, is asking to find their community, mm-hmm. they're transitioning or they're having trouble. Can you talk to them and things like that, just trying to find someone who's had the same experience with you. And I think that showing these photos from 2 years ago, what a change from even just 10 years ago, where there was, you know, one, two people. Mm-hmm. Now these, you know, teens, they have friends who are like them, and they are open and able to see more people in the media that are like them and feel okay with mm-hmm. themselves, and it makes my heart feel a lot of feelings.
I one of these presentations we put on, we did it where our son goes to high school. So, and what I notice is everyone's pretty open about it. It's not a, that, I mean, you have your people that need to work on it and stuff, but they're pretty okay with it. They're accepting. There's much more tolerance. I mean, there's kids that come through my house that say things, and I have to shut them down. You know, although I let them talk because I want to know what they're saying.
But at the end,
it's you know, a high school. I was always when I go there, it's like it's just more diverse. Period. And there are GSA clubs on campus. When I went to high school, you didn't have any of that. It was just you. You're on your own. Hopefully you had a pretty good parents that could accept it. If not, it's a hard road, So,
talking about things that happened 10 years ago, I remember back when I was in elementary school where we were pretty sure that this one boy in like our class is gay, and there was so much stigma around it. Even as just like elementary schoolers, maybe we didn't completely understand everything that went on, but we thought that this wasn't normal or right or anything like that. And it was, even then, like as someone who is that young, like still in elementary school, we could still understand that, like, there was still a lot of stigma behind it. And now things have really changed so much. Like last year when I was reuniting with my family overseas, news broke out that marriage equality was now like the law of the land. And so that really, and hearing my family's reactions about that with like the older generation being, you know, not so okay with it, but hearing my same aged cousins saying that, oh, it's like about time, and that they have so many friends who are also LGBT plus, it, and that they were accepting of their friends and whom they loved, and it really shows how much the world has changed, even if we haven't noticed it, even if it went by in like the blink of an eye.
Isn't that a testament to the media as well? You know, I feel like, especially in elementary school, like you're so changed by television and, and things that you see, and different kinds of people that you see, don't you think? You know, from a change from 10 years ago.
I think the internet plays into that.
Absolutely.
I mean, it's like when I was growing up, you had your old-fashioned newspaper, 3 channels on the TV, so you had a very filtered view of the world. I also think today's youth are just amazing people. It's like the older generation have more trouble with it. But I think you go back to the original, the Pride pictures, that's a testament to how far it's come along. There is progress being made. It's not done, but it's definitely moving that way. So I see younger people, and it's not a big deal. I'm like, yay, it worked.
I was just going to say, I teach theater to younger kids, and like when you guys are talking about the whole younger generation, we had one of our students who was in transition, and we as the teachers had a meeting about, you know, how the kids are going to react to it because we were concerned, and it was so beautiful to see that 90% of the kids just started calling her by her new name and went in like they weren't even fazed by it. And it was so wonderful to watch that now they're just so much more open that, okay, now her name is this. It's fine. Like, it wasn't, they didn't make it a big deal. The people that made it a big deal were the older parents.
How old were the kids?
The kids were 8 to 14.
Mm-hmm. Kids get it, man.
Yeah, and it was amazing because some of these people had known this individual since forever. And even those people were just like right into the transition. It was wonderful. It was amazing.
Kids get it.
No, kids totally.
Kids totally get it.
Like, you need to work on the older folks.
Absolutely.
They accept so much more and understand.
In general, they do.
So much more than adults who are like so set in their ways. And it's a nice thing to see when you see that even children can understand how important it is to respect people. And I guess kind of go along with the transition and call people how they want to be called and It's not that difficult.
It's not that difficult. I don't know. I don't understand why there's such a. I don't get it. It's not that difficult to have you be called by the name you choose to, you know, accept the gender that you choose.
Yeah.
This bathroom nonsense is just. I'm like, who elected these people? I mean, I know. We should have the kids run the world. I mean, they're just better at it.
I mean, nobody wants me in a lady dress.
Oh, I know. I know transgenders, and I was like, oh, no, you need to go in the men's room. Yeah. I mean, I don't know. What are they going to have, a little police outfit outside the restroom? I don't get it.
I think that's what some people would like. Transgender people are painted as predators, especially trans women, when there's not any evidence of, like, a trans woman going into a women's restroom and assaulting somebody. It's just never occurred.
And I mean, even people who are cisgender, like lesbian women, you don't see them assaulting other women in the restroom. You don't see bisexuals assaulting women or men in the restroom.
Also, frankly, a door that has a lady's sticker on it is not going to stop a guy from going in and assaulting you if he's going to assault you. Like, as morbid as that's going to be, like, the sticker on the door is not going to
change anything.
But back in the day, I think the predator thing was associated with being gay.
Yes, absolutely.
Absolutely. And I'm like, where did that one come from? I mean, it's just these people not getting to know people on a one-to-one and breaking down those barriers and boundaries.
They don't want to.
They're scared. I don't know what goes on in people's minds. I couldn't even guess at this point.
It might humanize somebody.
It might humanize. And it's like, unless you have a personal experience, like maybe you could come around, but it's just a bunch of fearful people. That's all it is. It's like, he gets tired of me ranting. It's like all these bedroom laws and all that. It's like, why? Well, there's more important things going on, believe me. Yeah.
Much more important things.
All right.
Done?
We've got somebody.
On that subject, my friend works in childcare in the YMCA in Tacoma, Washington. And she recently had a young child, I think kindergarten, start to transition. Mm. And she brought it up to her supervisor, the bathroom ordeal. And eventually, it was passed through to the higher ups, and each one was like, I mean, it's not that big of a deal, but I don't know, ask the next person. And it just kept getting passed up and passed up. And eventually the lead of the Washington YMCA was like, I mean, if the child identifies as male, they should use the men's bathroom. So I don't see the problem. But there were some people who were like, well, then my kid's being pulled out of the YMCA. And Washington's YMCA was like, you know what? Cool. Bye. Yeah. We don't want you here.
Before we wrap up, are there more questions? Perfect.
I just have a kind of anecdote. A dear friend of mine is transgender and is a woman, and he discovered, as being a woman, you are paid 77% of a man's wage.
That's male privilege for you.
Something else we're working on up in the back.
I think that's also interesting because there's such a much stronger stigma against going from male to female versus female to male, and I feel that in my own privilege, and it's like masculinity is so fragile, men see that as like a step down, like how could you do that, and they don't see it that way, when female goes to male. I think that's kind of interesting. It's an interesting point.
I'd like to say, first of all, thank you to all of you guys for speaking. But also, I just wanted to put out the point, I think the fight now really needs to be to also get this stuff in like the history books that are taught at schools. I think it's definitely like a sad thing that I went through my entire high school career, and in the history books I didn't hear mention once of Harvey Milk. I had to go out and find that information about myself, who like is a civil rights leader for the, I mean, was a civil rights leader for the LGBTQ plus community. And I just think that we definitely need to get that in the history books. It's not that the kids aren't as accepting, but it'll just make sure that this message is sent for the rest of, you know, throughout the generations. I think it's kind of a sad thing that we don't really have that in the history books that are standardized and taught at a lot of schools.
They're supposed to teach it. It's a state law. It's not being taught. That's how we were able to talk at the high schools, because it was a slippery slope, and so we presented it as a historical presentation. And it's the only LGBTQ history lessons the whole school got. And it's sad. I mean, history is written by, you know, whoever's point of view, I guess it is, but it helps to be included in the history books.
It's important.
It's important.
Even in college, I didn't really get much of history of the LGBT plus community until maybe I started getting into the club and joined Sally's human sexuality class. Yeah. I learned a bit more about it there.
You have to get to graduate level before you get to
college. You have a question here?
Yeah. It's more of a comment. I just like your talking about the Pride Parade, how it's all in black and white, and then moving to Gay Prom, how it's in color. I think that it's very powerful. I have friends in the LGBTQ community that are in my generation, and I, you know, I see the, you know, the color, the joy coming through them. Well, I also have a best friend who's 52 years old, and he's still living in this black and white, you know, fight. And I think that it's very powerful, just kind of seeing it through your photography. And I respect the fact that you were able to take this fight and you're trying to show it to everyone else, and thank you.
And we had a comment.
Back to Harvey Milk. Like I said, I lived in Nebraska, and my freshman year of high school, which was 2008-2009, we had a lesbian couple that wanted to attend prom together. And our administration had a serious issue with that, which for us as students was insane, to the point where we not only petitioned to allow them, we created a gay prom, and then the next year our musical was Milk. And we fought so bad for it that Westboro Baptist Church was across the lines picketing our high school.
Wow. Good. That's how you know you succeeded.
Coming from... I mean, I'm a Jewish woman and I'm bisexual. So having them picketing my high school, I had to be escorted out to my car. That was insane.
This 2009?
This was 2010. It was the next year. Wow. 2010. I had to be escorted to my car.
That is
crazy.
That is frightening.
We have a comment.
This type of comment only validates why we do this and why we will continue to do it. We'll continue to shoot the gay prom. We'll continue to shoot our HIV survivor folks. It's really important. And to jump off that, just one second with a question. And to take off on your comment, I often think about the fact that if you're a creative person, or not a creative, but in our case, a creative person, we're photographers, but a filmmaker, a writer, journalist, you can make a lot of impact by taking one step at a time and using those skills you have to make, it's a cliche, but I really believe in it, to make a difference. A little bit at a time, and pretty soon, it's like it just follows itself. And we can make a difference, you know. We, with our little project here, and it has gotten publicity. It's been published in Mother Jones. It was published in Life magazine 20 years ago. So I just want to put that out there. If anybody has a passion for a cause they really believe in that they want to document, you should do it. and don't necessarily think about the bottom line. That'll come. That'll come later. You should really do it if you believe in something, you know.
Well, first of all, it's been a pleasure hearing this panel discussion. My question is, going back to decades like the 70s and the 80s, the 60s and 70s, which brought a lot of change into our society, has it always been a goal for the gay community to assimilate into mainstream society? Like, get married?
I just think they want equal rights. I mean, they don't want anything more. I grew up in the Bay Area, the gay mecca of the world. To be hauled off to jail for who you are, that's horrible. To be beaten, to be sent to psychiatric hospitals, like there's something wrong with you. There's nothing wrong. There's nothing wrong, you know? And so it's just equal rights, the same footing, being able to marry who you love, getting some, you know, health insurance benefit, just the stuff that, you know, a lot of people take for granted up until 6 months ago didn't happen. Having children, adopting children, I mean, they make it hard. And so you have to, the other story that I'm very interested in is I call them the elderly gay warriors, is people that lived, you know, even like in the 40s, because it was a different world. I mean, totally closeted. And I'm so happy Carol was made. is that we set a group of people up by not allowing them to get married. Now they're in their 80s. They're by themselves because they couldn't have families. They couldn't have partners. It's just a total setup to them. And it's not right. And so, like I say, everyone should just have a chance. And not more, not less, just the same chance. And so that's why I think we keep doing what we do.
I have a little comment on that really quick. I think for me, the term assimilate nowadays has kind of a negative connotation to it, because it implies that you're giving up something in order to kind of fit in. And it kind of has this removal of culture, whether you're, you know, a different culture, a person of color, and maybe you're trying to assimilate into like white mainstream society, or if you're LGBT and you're assimilating into, you know, straight cisgender society. I think, you know, I'm young, so I wasn't there, but I think back then, assimilation was for safety.
Yeah.
It definitely wasn't that they were necessarily wanting to give up something like that, but they needed to assimilate to
survive.
To survive. To exactly.
Even now,
even
I
now.
Have to hide my identity among close friends and family just so that I can be safe, because I always have to face like homophobic and transphobic comments from my father and mother, and I think that the things that they say would be horrifying to most of you here right now. And so it's not that I don't want to be out and be myself where I can everywhere, but it's just that I can't, because there are still many professors on campus who are not like safe zone professors and not safe zone people. So you can't just be yourself wherever you are. It's pretty nerve-wracking, actually, when you're crossing the line and wondering, is it okay if I say something that aligns with myself, or should I just keep quiet and not say anything?
Like, what's easier?
What's easier? What's in my best interest? Should I stay safe, or should I risk something?
To be fair, I also think assimilation, the term assimilation also implies that we're not like normal in some way, that we needed to change ourselves in some way. We still go to the grocery store, you know? I would walk in the grocery store. I'm not assimilating into the grocery store. I am just myself at a grocery store, and you don't notice me because I'm at a grocery store. But, you know, it's not necessarily assimilation just to be yourself and fit in. You don't have to be out telling everyone constantly. Mm-hmm. You just have to be able to be who you are and let your own self show when it's, you know, right for you.
There are always also more facets to a person aside from their gender and their sexuality. Mm-hmm. So although those parts are, of course, very important and do determine how you act and behave and whom you love and interact with, they're not all that there is to us. There's, like, I'm a student. I'm also someone's sibling. I'm also bisexual. So what? Those things are all interconnected.
I just wanted to say something that it might sound a little strange at first, but hear me out. Respond to this as you would. Would the goal be necessarily acceptance, or would you actually rather want love from your actual those who you don't feel safe with? Because I think more personally, yes, in life you're going to get people who disagree with you, don't see eye to eye, who judge you by the way you look. Oh, you have a hair misplaced. How dare you? Whatever it may be. That's no, not you. You're beautiful. Don't worry. But my thing is, I'd love them for who they are as a person. I feel like love should be a natural right given to everyone, regardless of what you believe, say, feel, look, red, purple, green, whatever it may be. So what do you respond to that as you would? I mean, especially from your family perspective, would you rather feel, granted they go hand in hand, but would you rather see more that embracing of love as in like the unity of humanity? Or would you rather have them say, I don't know, like I accept you for fill in the blank, you know? Does that make sense?
Kind of.
It made more sense in my mind.
I feel you.
You picking them up and putting down?
I'm digging. I think that open hearts are extremely important. I think that's what maybe you're trying to get is to acceptance kind of comes along with it, I think.
Yeah.
It's the acceptance of that person, you know, that unconditional sort of, like, you are who you are, and that's okay to be who you are, even if I don't agree with you.
Mm-hmm.
And kind of giving the love that you wish to receive and coming at it from that angle.
Mm-hmm.
Like Nick said, they do, of course, go hand in hand. But I think, to me, for now, acceptance would be more important simply because I know that my family loves me for who I am, but they don't love every single part of me, especially because they don't know this part of me exists. To them, I'm just like a heterosexual, cisgender, Christian girl. That's all they know. That's all they care about. Like, as long as I maintain that image, then they will continue to accept me. But as for love, my mother still loves me. My father still loves me. I don't know about my brother, but I think that goes for most siblings. We don't know if our sibling really loves us until later.
Yeah.
You'll find out later. Until you're older.
To live with them.
Yeah, exactly. Then you appreciate how much they mean to you. But for now, I think acceptance is more important, because if I had to come out to my parents, they'd probably kick me out of the house, or at least they'd have me live on the condition that you have to marry a man when you're older. You don't get to marry someone of another gender if they're not like male bodied or something. That is really frustrating at times. So
sorry, I don't want to cut you short. I think we're going to wrap it up soon, but I wanted to give the panelists kind of a last opportunity.
One
more question. We'll take one more question, and then if you guys have any last thoughts. Oh, where's she sitting?
All the way.
Oh, here, and then Susan, and then.
I was just on the issue of labels. I was curious, like, where is
the
balance?
Could you talk louder, please?
Oh yeah, on the issue of labels, I was curious as to where the balance comes from, identity and labels, like the balance between those two. because it seems like labels have a lot of baggage with them. And the second you say you're in one category, whether it's religious or political or sexual preference, it causes problems once there's a label. So how is there a balance between, or how could there be a balance between identity and a label if getting rid of labels is a goal, which I think is a good goal?
I believe labels are a safety net.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Absolutely.
Putting yourself in a box suddenly creates a community within that box.
Yes.
Saying, I am part of this label, where are my other people in this label?
Who relate to how I feel.
Right.
Like, I know that a lot of people don't like choosing the label bisexual because of the stigma that comes with it and the ideas that other people have that, like, bisexuals are unfaithful or they can't choose or they're selfish or whatever, like, crap that comes along with it. But I think if what you're asking is how do these labels and identities, like, balance, well, it took me a lot of time to come to terms with myself. I understood already that I was bisexual, but I had to sort of reconcile my faith with my identity as being bisexual as well. And that took a lot of time. And if you find that, your faith doesn't conform to what other people say, you have to look into that other label yourself. You have to find if what other people are saying are really true, and you have to investigate. Because I had to look long and hard for the answers I was looking for to whether, like, being bisexual or gay was okay with what I believed in, and I found that it was okay because there's really not a strong law, like, condemning it, and
so it took you the label in order to bring about that resolution for you.
Kind of, and
I would have to agree a little bit, just mainly because I knew I was lesbian, like, literally since I was, like, 5.
Oh, wow.
But I was never scared of it. I was just more of, I mean, I guess it ties into your question as well, whether it's love or acceptance. I waited until, I want to say, 2 years ago to come out, mainly because I was waiting for everyone. I was waiting to feel comfortable enough in my skin to accept myself the most to not need anyone else's acceptance when I came out. So I waited until I was about 19. Mm-hmm. To come out, because that's when I accepted myself so much that I didn't need anyone else's acceptance. But it was nice, because within that, I had established all the acceptance from my friends and family that I needed to make it that much easier when I came out, which is weird.
Yeah, I'm honestly, for me, I just think that I hope that one day we can all just be people.
Yeah.
And it's not, you'd be like, oh, this is my girlfriend, this is my boyfriend, whatever. And it's not necessarily that it's not spoken, but that it's not a thing that needs to be spoken,
right.
And that we can all just be people,
totally
human people.
Not be
I can relate with that, just mainly because the girl I'm dating now isn't in full acceptance of it, mm-hmm. which is hard. It's a real struggle. So what I've learned is that a label is constraining. It does put you in a box.
Mm-hmm.
And for her, with no label, it's easier for us to love each other.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas I mean, I guess misleadingly, I needed for a long, like, for the first, like, couple months when we were originally dating, I needed that label because I needed that security.
Mm-hmm.
But then, I don't know, something flipped for me, and I think it was just realizing that she actually does love me.
Yeah.
For me to not need that label, and realizing how much of a, like, how constraining that label is.
Mm-hmm.
And now when I introduced her, I just said, this is the girl I love.
Yeah. And when I first started dating men, and I date gay men, and first gay man I dated, was like, oh, I'm gay, but you're trans. What do I do? And I'm like, date me?
Do you like me?
Yeah, because he was so constrained by his label of gay that he couldn't break out of it and accept, you know, who I was and that he was, you know, in love with me at the time. And so it was hard for him. And I hope that one day that that's not a struggle that needs to be fought.
Is that what ended?
No.
Things? No?
Okay.
That's one of my fears, is that eventually the whole label thing will end things between me and her, but I have that much faith that our love is strong enough that it won't. And it's brought us this far, so
I wish you the best.
Yeah.
I want to say something on the contrary, that labels are confining. I don't think that this is entirely the case. For me, as someone who identifies as bisexual, there's a lot of fluidity and a lot of freedom in identifying as bisexual, and I don't think that there is really anything confining about it, because to me, when I was trying to find out who I was, I kept shuffling through labels to try to
I've been there.
Yes.
to really properly understand who I was. And so, like, I went through identifying as heterosexual, asexual, lesbian, and finally I'm back to, I'm now at the end, at bisexual, and I think that this is something, I think people shouldn't underestimate or really, how do I say it?
Where's the last one?
Like, make negative the power of labels, because labels can definitely empower someone as well and bring together a community to support you.
It's just a matter of how you manage everything.
Right, I think so.
Okay, so I think we're going to take one last comment.
Oh, okay.
And then I want to invite everybody to go to the art gallery in the administration building for the reception afterwards.
Okay.
Okay, this is a little scary because I'm over 65. I'm 65, so I hope that doesn't, you know. And I want to say that what Ashley said was what I was going to speak to, which is something going on in this country right now that involves politics and religion and the evangelicals that are coming out. And I recently saw the crews stepping on the stage with that horrible preacher. And that really made me sick. And how are we going to fight against that evangelical and still accept them for who they are? Like Ashley says, her religion, you know, my God is a forgiving God and an accepting God.
So. Thank you.
Do you guys have anything you want to comment on that or have any closing statements you want to make before we move over to the reception?
From our point of view, we need to, and other creative people, we need to continue to do work like this, to put it out there. I mean, look at the discussion that's been taking place. Our work was a jumping board to all this discussion and conversation, and get us to talk like this. So, I just think a lot more people need to be doing work like this if they feel passionate about it, because this isn't easy.
Like Sandra had mentioned earlier too, and her and I were discussing, it's not a point A to point B, it's just a continuous process, and if we take it upon our generation and future generations to just continue to have discussions like these, it will change. There will be a change. It's slowly happening. It just needs to continue to happen. I think that's the one thing that we all have to kind of instill.
I think you just got to keep plugging along. If you asked me 30 years ago if, you know, there would be marriage equality, I'd laughed in your face. So it doesn't happen overnight. It just takes an individual, any of you, just do something. I don't know what you guys do. Do something in a positive way to impact your community. I respect everyone. I don't agree with everyone. And no one agrees with me a lot of the time, but it's about respect too. And what I see on the national scene right now is just, it's horrifying to me. Absolutely horrifying, because it's not trying to unite people. I think we need to unite people. Everyone is not having one group over the other. It's just being equal. And but that's hard for some people to accept, so you gotta just keep plugging away with whatever you do. And I don't know, if you're a creative person, I use my camera as my tool. If you're a writer, write. If you're, whatever you do, if you're a teacher, teach. I mean, let's get out there and change the world. There's a lot of stuff going on that's wrong, and this is what we do in our little way. And if we can impact, you know, some people, I'm kind of happy about that. I'm not asking for the world. I'm just asking for people to respect each other. So do what you can do. That's my speech.
Thank you again, guys. Thank you for being here.